Welcome back, everyone, to NCAA Football 14 Road to Glory. Today, we will end the 2015 season with the off-season video. My junior year came to a perfect end as the Bearcats not only went undefeated, but also brought home a national championship after a 34-21 win over the South Carolina Gamecocks. Pretty much a perfect game for us. No turnovers. The defense did their job, and it was a perfect way to cap off a very, very interesting season. We didn't really have the strongest schedule this year, but when games were close, they went down to the wire. Games like the one against Memphis, UCF, Houston, and of course the game in week 14 against Rutgers, a very, very narrow escape, but the Bearcats would win the American Conference for the third straight year and finish number one in the top 25 polls to end the year. Going to be interesting to see where this team ends up starting out next year in the top 25 polls after winning a national championship and not being a Power 5 team. But my stats from this season were kind of up and down in some areas. My receptions were down. My yards were down. Yards per catch was up. Touchdowns up by 4. Yards per game was down by 50.4. But my yards after the catch were up. There was a lot of really, really long catches for touchdowns this year. And then my drops were also down, so that's not too bad at all. My blocking definitely improved from last year. 32 pancake blocks, the best receiving or the best blocking receiver in the nation right now. 32, that's kind of big. That's more than our offensive linemen. And then rushing the ball this year, only 9 carries for 52 yards. So my carries were down, my yards were up, but I didn't have any touchdowns on the ground this year. We didn't get a lot of those reverses in the red zone that we normally get. Tion Green scored a lot from inside the 5, so not too much to worry about there. Fumbles also were up from last year. And I also got a tackle this year, and I did not get one last year, so that's good to see, although it's not really good to be getting tackles on offense. I mean, something bad happened. But I bring home the Heisman for the second time in my career, sophomore and junior year. I bring home the Heisman. Freshman year, Johnny Manziel won it. But Patrick Coyne on the season, 197 QB rating, 4,600 yards almost through the air, 47 touchdowns, 13 interceptions down from last year, 353 yards per game, throwing 74% and sacked 17 times. Not too bad. One of the big changes for us this year was the addition of an actual running game. Tion Green carried the ball 244 times for over 1,000 yards on the season. That's the first time ever in the history of me playing this game where I've had a running back run for over 1,000 yards. This has been a special team. He had 14 touchdowns, broke 20 tackles, fumbled once, and had one carry longer than 20 yards. Deontay Buckley, who will most likely be the starter next year, had a pretty good season, 233 yards on 57 carries. Patrick Coyne was 54 for 27. Jared Golden was 6 for 18, and the only other scoring running back on the team, and we had some other receivers with some carries as well. And now we'll take a look at the receivers. You saw my numbers already, but DJ Doughty, second in receptions and yards. Javon Harrison, 49 catches on the year. Chris Moore in his final year, 34 catches, 463 yards, and 3 touchdowns. Travis Johnson, the backup tight end, had a pretty good year, had a touchdown. And then Deontay Buckley was 9 for 34. Nate Cole, 5 for 72. And Jared Golden, 5 for 25. Shaquem Alonzo was 1 for 8. And then, of course, all the way at the bottom is L. Jr., the running back who we never see, had 1 catch and 4 yards. But like I was talking about with the pancake blocks, 32 on the year, I lead the team. And then most sacks given up goes to left tackle Nick Dubzinski. Of course, he is the lowest overall offensive lineman on the team. Parker Ehringer had 3. Deontay Buckley had 2. Justin Murray had 2. And then Bond, Green, Horton, and Brown all gave up 1. So the offensive line, major improvements compared to last year. Cedric Marshall, the 58 overall middle linebacker, leads the team in tackles with 54, just ahead of Brad Hara. But in terms of tackles for a loss and sacks, Brad Hara took that home easily. 19 tackles for a loss and 13 sacks, which will lead the team. But Jamal West behind him, Silverberry Moon. We have a lot of players on this team that contributed as well. Tenier Orr led the team in interceptions, but look at all the INTs brought back this year. Eshaw McClain had one in the national championship to begin the third quarter, which was clutch. Marcus Foster had a couple of game-ending interceptions. Jones, Tyson, Cassius, Wilson, Bruins, Brown, Payne, Marshall, and of course West. And then fumble recoveries. Every fumble we forced this year was also recovered. So we had 2 from Cedric Marshall. He had 1 each in the national championship. Big game for him. And then looking at the blocks, Eshaw McClain and Kevin Brown each had 1. And then for safeties, still no safeties on the year, but defensive touchdowns finally getting 1 this year as Eshaw McClain finally helped the defense get some points on the board. We had none of those the first 2 years, and it's good to see that finally happening. Moving on to kicking, Ben Espinosa, the freshman kicker, 14 of 16 for 87%. Longest attempt was from 38 yards. He was 60 for 62 on extra point attempts for 96%, and he missed 2 inside of 30 But the 9 he kicked from 30 to 39 yards were good. Didn't attempt any outside of 40 yards. And he did not handle kickoffs. That went to Jeff Simmons, who had 91 kickoffs on the season and 40 touchbacks. So not a bad year for our kickers. Now let's look at the punting from Jeff Simmons, who has pretty much become a, not exactly an expert, but he's done the job punting the past 2 years. 44 average and then a 40.5 net. That's like 3.5 yards a return. Wasn't blocked at all this year. 4 punts inside the 20 and 6 of them were touchbacks. And now the return game, which I really wish I was a part of, but Nate Cole, 21 returns, 428 yards, and Chris Moore, 10 returns for 292 and 1 touchdown. And then Nate Cole getting in on the special teams touchdowns with 28 returns, 276, and then 1 that went back for 67 yards and a touchdown. And now it's time to take a little deep dive into the team stats, starting with offense. So the Bearcats finished with a little shy of 7,100 total offensive yards, 6,100 on offense, 4,663 through the air, 1,437 on the ground, 38.7 points per game, 48 passing touchdowns, 15 on the ground, and allowing 18 sacks, and we picked up 253 first downs. So we'll take a look at how the other teams in the nation did, as Oregon almost had 9,100 total yards on the year, and then Pitt at the bottom with 4,689. Moving on to total offensive yards, is Oregon at the top of the list once again, 72-19, and then at the bottom is once again Pittsburgh with 31-83. Passing yards, Bearcats in the top five, but ECU would take it home with 58-65 through the air. And then at the bottom is Army with only 13-52, but those teams at the bottom of the list would be at the top when it comes to rushing. Georgia Tech, 4,100 yards on the ground this year. Army in there with 30-50. Oregon, Wisconsin, and Florida State up there as well. And then the least rushing yards on the year goes to Washington State. Maybe they need a running back next year or in the next series that I do. I don't know. We'll think about it. Texas A&M with the highest points per game, 45.2. Oregon right behind them. And then at the bottom is Pitt once again, 13 points per game. They finished the year 2-10, of course. They would have a low points per game. Passing touchdowns on the year, ECU 62, Oregon 51, Texas A&M at 51, Bearcats with 48. And then the lowest amount of passing touchdowns goes to Old Dominion. Most rushing touchdowns goes to Georgia Tech. They had 45, Navy behind them with 35, and Northern Illinois with 33. And then Cal Berkeley, the Golden Bears, only had 5 rushing touchdowns on the year. That's a very, very, very low number. You should at least have 10. But sacks allowed, that's a really high number right there. 46 given up by Iowa State. Ole Miss in there as well with 43. And then Army with the least amount with 14. But the Bearcats in there as well with 18. We have the lowest amount of sacks from teams that don't run a wishbone offense. Because if you think about it, those wishbone teams don't really throw that much. So of course, they would have really low sack numbers. But the first downs most picked up this year is by Oregon, 362. And the least is by Wyoming, 174. Bearcats with 253. Kind of in the middle there. But of course, we're a big play offense. Now let's take a look at our defense. Giving up 4,556 total yards, 3,859 through the air, 697 on the ground, 287 given up in points, 28 sacks on the year, 16 fumble recoveries, and then 17 INTs. Our team, or our defense, was taking the football away this year. And the most yards given up was by Georgia State, 6,352. And the least given up is by Navy, a little over 4,000, just 1 yard over 4,000 given up on the year. Very good Navy team. Would have been a pretty interesting national championship against them. But the most passing yards given up this year, Georgia State once again number one. But the Bearcats still up there in the top 10 with a little over 3,800 given up on the year. But Navy once again the least amount of passing yards given up, just shy of 2,000. Pretty good defense on that Navy squad. Rushing yards given up this year, Idaho with the most, 2,537. And the least, of course, is the Cincinnati Bearcats, 697 rushing yards given up on the year. We only gave up 559 last year, so slightly an improvement. Taking a look at most points given up, that's by SMU with 498. And the least given up by Navy, once again, they are at the top of every list, or at the bottom pretty much of every list. Most sacks on the year is by West Virginia with 56, and Air Force only had 16 on the season. Fumble recoveries, the Bearcats do lead this category with 16 fumble recoveries. Behind us, Iowa State with 13, and the least amount of fumble recoveries goes to Ball State, who only had 1. And then the interceptions, South Carolina actually leads this with 24, but they had no interceptions or no forced turnovers for that matter in the national championship game. They could have really used one. And then at the bottom of the interception list is Indiana with only 5 on the year. Now let's take a look at the conversions. Bearcats with 80 third down conversions on 146 attempts. That's 54% on the year, down from last year. 10 of 11 on fourth downs for 90%. That's up from last year. And then 3 of 4 on two-point conversions, which is 75%, which is up from last year. Once again, not only in attempts, but also in percentage. So the leader in third down conversion percentage this year is Oregon with 63%. We were up kind of towards that area last year, but of course we got caught in a lot of third and long situations, and then sometimes we would go for it on fourth down, so it's not too bad overall. Wyoming with the lowest amount with 31%, and we actually do lead in fourth down conversion percentage. So a lot of those third downs we don't get, we end up going for it on fourth down anyway. And then BYU with only 14% of fourth down conversions being converted. And now let's take a look at our red zone numbers. Bearcats with 66 attempts in the red zone, 33 were touchdowns, 12 were field goals, and that's 68% in the red zone. That's a horrible number, way lower from last year. That's 10% lower from last year. And then the defensive red zone, 53 attempts allowed, 31 touchdowns allowed, and then 5 field goals. That's 65%, and that's up 3% from last year. So you're looking at the leaders this year, Alabama with 90% in the red zone. That's absolutely monstrous. Also on the top is Northwestern. And then Kansas and Utah State at the bottom with 60%. The Bearcats not too far off with 68%. We threw a lot of interceptions in the red zone. But Northwestern had one of the best red zone offenses and one of the worst red zone defenses. 93% of trips in the red zone allowed points. Navy, one of the best. And then the Bearcats not too far off with 65%. So not a bad year. Overall, Florida leads in penalties with 125. Bearcats at the bottom with only 38 penalties. And then taking a look at who gave up the most yards via penalties, that is Mississippi State with over 1,100 penalty yards. That's not good at all. But the turnover differential is the major area of improvement for this Bearcats team. Plus 19 on the year, 14 giveaways via interceptions only, no fumbles lost this year, 13 takeaways, 17 INTs, and then 16 fumble recoveries. And we'll take a look at how we compare to the rest of the league. Of course, we are number one in differential, and then at the bottom is Colorado with minus 13. That is not good at all. Miami, the Hurricanes, 28 giveaways on the year, 16 INTs, and 12 lost fumbles. And then the most careful team in college football this year is San Diego State with only 8 giveaways. Most interceptions thrown this year, that is Colorado with 21 and Georgia Tech with only 3 and Florida State with 4. Fumbles lost this year, the leader is Texas with 15. And then the most careful team with the football, of course, is the Bearcats. No fumbles lost on the year. Takeaways, we were second to South Carolina. They had 35, we had 33. We had 3 takeaways in the national championship, I'm pretty sure. But let's take a look at some of the leaders when it comes to stats across the board. Patrick Coyne leads in rating and will only come second to Cody Keefe when it comes to passing yards. He threw over 5,000. Patrick Coyne threw 5,800 last year, I'm pretty sure, something around that. And then Cody Keefe also with 59 passing touchdowns, Coyne in second. Yards per game, Keefe with 395 through the air, Coyne in third. And then completion percentage, Patrick Coyne number one with 74%. And then moving on to rushing. Attempts leader this year on the ground with 289 carries. Tim Gay of Texas State rush yard leader this year is Jeremy Hill with 1,600 yards on the ground. Rush touchdown leader once again is Tim Gay at the top of the list with 22 rushing touchdowns. And then the yards per game leader is Cody Walker of Arkansas with 123.8 yards on the ground. Tim Gay right behind him with 119.4. And now taking a look at the wide receivers, and that's the wrong Robertson at the top of the list. Brian Robertson, freshman receiver from East Carolina, beats me for receptions on the year, but of course I lead in yards and then also touchdowns with Shaq Rowland of South Carolina right behind me. We both had 2 in the national championship. Yards per game, I lead this as well with 208.3 a game. And then the yards after the catch, I also lead this with 1,084. So not a bad year overall, and we're just going to take a quick look at the defensive leaders. We're not going to go through everything, but tackle leader this year is Brandon Golson of FAU. Tackle for loss leader is Franklin Thomas of Oklahoma. Sack leader is Brad Hara. 13 sacks on the year, and the Bearcats once again leading in another statistic. Looking at interceptions, Marshall Taylor of Miami with 10 on the year, Haynes with 9. Defensive touchdowns goes to Jacob May of Ball State. He had 3, and then a bunch of guys with 2. We had a guy with 1. And then looking at the All-Americans this year, I make the list as a first-teamer, and unfortunately, Patrick Coyne is not on the list as a first-teamer. So we'll keep moving down here. Parker Arringer makes the list. Brad Harrod makes the list. And then you have Jamal West making the list as well. And then moving a little further down, can we get one more guy on the list? Safety's not there. Kicker's not there. And that would do it for the first team All-Americans. But the freshmen, Brent Horton makes the list as a freshman at right guard. Jamal West makes the list as a defensive tackle. He was also first team All-American. And then Cedric Marshall makes the list as a freshman All-American. But then, of course, we have to look at the All-American All-Americans, and it's a bunch of Bearcats on this list. Patrick Coyne, Teon Green, myself, Justin Murray at left guard, Michael Brown at center, a guy from USF at right guard, Parker Ettinger makes the list, Brad Hara makes the list at left end, Jamal West and Brandon Mitchell, Cedric Marshall all make the list, Tenier Orr makes the list, TJ Johnson, my rival from Rutgers, makes the list, Kevin Brown, Marcus Foster, Ben Espinosa, and Nate Cole all make the list. So what a season for Bearcats football. But let's take a look at some of the seniors that are leaving us this year. Patrick Coyne, career stats, only 2 years as a starter. Wish I could have one more with him, but unfortunately he is leaving and I might be leaving as well. But over 10,000 yards, 96 touchdowns, 34 INTs, 394 per game, throwing 72% on his career, and sacked 34 times. Teon Green, just shy of 1,900 yards in his career, 4.2 yards a carry, 30 touchdowns, 47.6 points per game, which is low because he was a backup, and they obviously have to count that in when he was behind Abernathy. One carry of more than 20 yards, 81 broken touchdowns, and 3 career fumbles. You can see the rest of the running back numbers there, but Chris Moore, another senior, leaving us this year, 128 receptions, 1,300 yards, 8 touchdowns, 34.1 yards per game. Not the greatest thing in the world. I obviously took over when I came in to this program, and 13 career drops, not bad at all. And then the defense, Trinier Orr all the way down to Kevin Brown. Those are kind of like the key seniors leaving. So you'll see that he finished with 98 career tackles, and I'm just reading off Trinier Orr's numbers here. 7 INTs for 3 yards. So unfortunately, no returns for him. 7 pass deflections, 1 forced fumble, 1 fumble recovery, 1 block. And that would pretty much do it. No defensive touchdowns for this guy. And then looking at the updated records, Patrick Coyne with the updated career touchdown record. And then I broke a bunch of records this year, also updating a bunch of records this year. So the career numbers are going to keep increasing. The receiving touchdowns in a season was broken this year. The yards in a career obviously is going to keep updating. Receptions in a career is going to keep updating. But not a lot was really broken this year. A lot of these numbers were for 2014, my sophomore year. There is just no beating that sophomore year. It was too good. But moving on to the NCAA records for an individual in a season, Patrick Coyne with the record for QB rating 197 at the end of the year. Cody Keefe with 59 touchdowns has that record. And the only thing I updated this year was, of course, the receiving touchdowns in a year with 40. And then moving on to the individual career records in the NCAA, all this stuff is going to keep getting updated. 103 touchdowns in a career, 7,921 yards, and then 407 receptions. But of course, guys, it is time to make the decision for whether or not I will be staying or leaving for the NFL. I did a poll, and the result was 53-47 in favor of leaving for the NFL, but I'm going to stay anyway. We're getting ready for the senior year, the senior season 2016. I want another national championship. And I felt like the voting was close enough. There's enough people that want to see another year. And right now, the timing is just really good. I've got 4 more months until Madden 17 comes out, which is what I'll be taking this series into. And it really didn't make any sense for this series to just be sitting, not being played. So one more year. As 2016 is officially here, week 1 opening up on the road against Purdue, and the Bearcats are number 11 in the preseason polls. Not sure how that happened, but the Bearcats will open up against Purdue, then we have 2 bye weeks, then we face Miami, Ohio, another bye week, then we play Memphis, then we're on the road again to play Southern Florida, then Louisville, BYU, Houston on the road, Central Florida on the road, UConn back at home, Temple will be my final home game. Then we have Rutgers on the road, and then Southern Methodist on the road to end the year in week 15. But now let's take a look at the top 25 a little more in depth. Oregon will have the number 1 spot to begin the year, but of course we all know that upsets happen every single week in this series. So if I was Oregon, I would be watching out for an upset, especially South Carolina. How did they get ranked ahead of us and we beat them in the national championship? I don't get it, but Nebraska is the number 25. And here is your new Bearcats offense, new starting quarterback, junior, Trent Slaughter. 88 overall, 90 speed, has very good throwing attributes. Very excited to see what he can do out there on the field. Deontay Buckley is the new starting running back, 85 overall, 87 speed. And then backing him up is senior running back L. Jr., who has number 56. It's very, very, very confusing why he has that number, but of course, it doesn't really matter. Ashton Alexander is the new starting fullback. He is a senior as well. He is a 77 overall. Pretty decent speed, not the greatest awareness in the world. Going to be watching out for him on those outside run blocks. And then, of course, the receiving core. I'm still starting 99 overall. Javon Harrison up to a 89 overall. Not the greatest speed, but Nate Cole in the slot with 97 speed and 99 acceleration. Very excited to see what he can do. Travis Johnson still in there at wide receiver 4. Shaquem Alonso should get some decent playing time this year. And then redshirt freshman Adam Cunningham has good speed. I want to see what that guy can do on the field. DJ Dowdy back for a senior year, 93 overall, and then Travis Johnson, 89. Our tight ends are still very, very good. And now the offensive line, left tackle Nick Dobzinski up to a 72 overall, Kyle Williamson, 82 overall, Michael Brown up to an 88 overall. Moving on to right guard is going to be All-American Brent Horton, 83 overall, and then at right tackle, we just can't have a complete offensive line on this team. Jason Stevens, sophomore, 69 overall. Now the defense, we've had a lot of guys to replace. Let's see how we did in recruiting. So junior Mark Wilson will step up. He gets to start this year. Freshman Kent Arnold, 81 overall. That's a big time pickup. Trying to replace Silverberry Mowen, not exactly the same overall, but let's see what he can do. And then a defensive tackle is All-American Jamal West in his sophomore year. Senior linebacker Rasheen Jones out there at left outside linebacker, 80 overall. Pretty decent speed, great acceleration. Middle linebacker is not Cedric Marshall. It's Corey Hodge, a freshman who he brought in. And Cedric Marshall is still on the team, but Hodge has the higher overall, and all the other guys on the team have a higher overall as well, and they've still been on the team for quite some time. Eshawn McLean, outside linebacker, very excited to see what he can do this year, 87 overall. And then, of course, the secondary starting with the cornerbacks, an area of concern, but Mike Tyson up to an 84 overall, Drake Bruins up to an 80 overall. We have A.J. Ferguson, a 72 overall. And then it's Martin Jackson, a 69 overall, a sophomore. And then Talib Bowen, a freshman, a 68 overall. So we're not doing too bad here. Could be better. Andre Jones stepping in at free safety, 89 overall. And then Marcus Foster still back there at strong safety. The senior, ready for a big year, 86 overall. Expecting a lot from him. And then Ben Espinosa, our All-American kicker, 81 overall. Very excited to see what he can do this year. And then Jeff Simmons, 81 overall as well. He should just keep doing what he's doing. Now, my skills this year, this first page is pretty much all wrapped up. Only thing is the 97 route running, but then we move down and my release is finally in the 80s. I started in like the 50s my freshman year. It's been a grind trying to get off the line, but I'm doing a pretty good job of upgrading that as we go along. And here's the Heisman top five to begin the year. Myself, Jameis Winston, Overstreet, Smith, and then Hack. Trying to come away with three straight Heismans and two straight national championships here in 2016. Hope you guys enjoyed the offseason video. I know these are super long. They've got to be long. There's a lot of stuff to go over. But looking very forward to the senior year. Hope you guys are excited for one more year of Bearcats football. This offense might be even more dynamic than it was last year with Trent Slaughter's running ability, but of course with the running ability comes a tendency to run a little too often on design passing plays. But on the read options and the inverted veers, I'm expecting him to really take off and give us that really additional element that Patrick Queen kind of did and he kind of had, but there's that speed factor and Trent Slaughter has it. So I'm really looking forward to seeing what he can do in week one against Purdue. A pretty easy game for us, or at least it should be, to try to test our waters, because our practice, that really wasn't the greatest practice in the world. There was a lot of just miscommunication, a lot of missed time throws. Like I said earlier, there's a lot of running from Trent Slaughter when I'm open down the field. So we'll kind of see how that goes. The first practice was kind of okay, but week one against Purdue will be coming in a couple of weeks. I'm not exactly sure when, but you guys should follow me on Twitter for updates. I will let you guys know when week one and probably like the first 4 or 5 weeks of the year will be uploaded, because these bye weeks at the beginning of the year are kind of getting annoying. But of course, I will see you guys then. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed. Stay tuned for more Bearcats football. See you guys then.